Have you ever wondered how an electric iron works? This drawing will show you what the inside of an iron looks like and what makes it heat up. The bottom of the iron is called the sole plate. On top of it is placed the heating element, which is insulated from the sole plate. The electricity flows into the element through two contacts. Here they are. The contacts must be insulated from the metal of the iron to prevent a short circuit. These are the insulating mica washers. Two pins are connected to the contacts. They project above the cover of the iron. The third wire is the earth conductor or earth wire, which is there for safety. The current flows in through the two conductors to the element, which becomes very hot and in turn heats the sole plate. If any electricity should leak into the frame of the iron, the earth wire will conduct it away in safety. Now let's build a real iron, remembering the diagram of how everything works. First comes the sole plate, then the element between two sheets of mica for insulation, then the clamping plate, a heavy sheet of metal which is bolted down. Now the cover and the handle. Behind the handle, there's a projecting piece of metal called the terminal shroud. The plug, carrying the flex, fits inside it. Do you notice the rubber sleeve on the flex? It's there to protect the wires from being exposed through constant movement. So now we've assembled the iron and it's ready for use. It's an ordinary electric iron, and it has to be tested to see if it's at the right heat. But the thermostatic iron has a device which automatically controls its temperature. The thermostat is controlled by this knob. It's worked by a strip made of two different metals welded together, called the bimetal strip. A light pin is attached to the strip. It's fastened to the upper one of two springy pieces of metal and rises or falls with it. These pieces of metal carry the current. A diagram will show you exactly how the bimetal strip works. You can see the strip down at the bottom of the picture. When the strip gets hot, one of the metals expands more quickly than the other, which makes the strip bend upwards, like this. As the iron cools down, one of the metals contracts more quickly, and the strip is straightened out. Let's watch it again. Expand up, contract down. Now let's see it from another angle. The current comes in here, across the contacts, along this strip, and so to the other contact pin, completing the circuit. With the current running through, the iron heats up. The bimetal strip bends upwards, and the pin rises, carrying the two contacts with it. This cam, attached to the control knob, fixes the point at which the bottom one is held. The top one goes on rising. Contact is broken, and the current ceases to flow. The iron cools, the metal strip relaxes, and the contact points meet again. So if you set the thermostat control to a low temperature, contact is broken early. If to a high one, contact is broken later. The light in the handle, which glows when the iron is getting hot, goes out when the temperature set by the control knob is reached, and the iron is ready for use.
Here's a demonstration of how to use the thermostatic iron. First, you should get all the things together you want to iron and arrange them according to the amount of heat the materials need for proper ironing. For example, silk should have a low heat and cotton a higher one. The lowest temperature of all is needed by artificial silk, rayon and nylon, so the control knob is first set to art silk. When the indicator light in the handle goes out, you know that the iron is at exactly the right temperature. This rayon petticoat was rolled in a clean cloth before it was dry to keep it damp enough for ironing. The lace on the hem should be done first. It must be ironed on the wrong side or it will become shiny. The seam should be done next with the point of the iron. Always do the double parts, hems and seams, before the rest of the garment. Now the bodice. Be careful and stretch it a bit to prevent the tiny gathers from becoming creases. Now the skirt. First, look to see how the threads run. Here they run crossways. You should iron with the weave, like this, to keep the material in shape. The iron should be a little hotter for real silk. Like artificial silk, real silk should be ironed damp. The shoulders of the blouse should be done first, and it's best to do them on a sleeve board. After you've done the sleeves, iron the rest of the blouse on the ordinary ironing board. When they're finished, it's very important to fold and hang the clothes up carefully. Dark materials of all kinds must be ironed on the wrong side, or the surface will become shiny. For wool, the iron must be hotter still. Never iron wool damp like other materials. Iron it when it's dry, or it will shrink. The way you fold certain articles before you iron them is very important. Trousers must have the creases just right. Lay a damp cloth over the crease and press with the iron so that you don't upset the crease. When the cloth is dry, you can smooth with the iron without doing any harm. Cotton needs a still higher temperature. You must iron it fairly damp. Stretch the material well so that the tip of the iron goes right up into the gathers. For linen, the iron must be hottest of all. Stretch your linen napkin like this, so that the four edges are quite straight. Linen should be ironed on the right side. Now use heavy strokes and iron till the material is quite dry, remembering that hems take longer to dry than the rest of the material. Fold the napkin in three, press, fold it in three again, and press again. An embroidered piece of linen, like this tray cloth, should be ironed on the wrong side, or the embroidery will be flattened out. Iron it over a thick pad of material. Press well, and you'll make the embroidered pattern stand out effectively. And now, the last word of warning. When you finish, don't wind the flex round the handle while the iron is still hot, or the heat will ruin the rubber insulation. Just put the flex on one side and stand the iron up to cool.